Morning, everyone. Welcome to the Saginaw County Board of Commissioner meeting. Leap year, it's February 29th, 10 a.m. It's our regular board session, and we open our meeting with pledge allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Commissioner Frankert will lead us in prayer today.
Since we're still in February and last week was President's Day and we had National Alphabet Day week, I found a prayer that Abe Lincoln did. So I think go ahead and recite that. I think it's appropriate even as of today. So please bow our heads. Almighty God, who has given us this good land for our heritage, we humbly beseech thee that we may always prove ourselves a people mindful of thy favor and glad to do thy will. Bless our land with honorable ministry, sound learning, and pure manners, such from violence, discord, and confusion, from pride and arrogance, and from every evil way. Defend our liberties and fashion into one united people. The multitude brought hither out of many kindreds and tongues, endow thy spirit of wisdom those whom in thy name we entrust the authority of government, that there be justice and peace at home, and that though through obedience to thy law, we may show forth thy praise among the nations of the earth. In time of prosperity, fill our hearts with thankfulness, and in the day of trouble, suffer not our trust in thee to fail. All of which we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Abraham Lincoln.
Abraham Lincoln, yeah.
Yeah, very nice.
Roll call, please.
Commissioner Paradiso?
Here.
Commissioner Schuff?
Here.
Commissioner Frankert?
Here.
Here. So first thing on our agenda, we have a bid opening. Barb?
Sorry. Set a signing sheet around. And then I guess I will turn it over to Brian. I've never done this type of a bid opening before, so
you might want to explain what an AWOS is.
Yeah. So what we're doing is
This is Brian from Stantec, our airport engineering consultant for Seneca County.
Yes.
Thank you.
And what we did is last May we applied for a grant through ODOT Office of Aviation to replace their AWOS at the airport. That's your automatic weather station. Theirs is 20 plus years old and beyond its life. It's an old analog system that can't be serviced anymore. What we were doing was receiving bids for a new up-to-date digital system that hopefully will last them another 20 plus years. So not expecting a lot of bids on this. We've got one that looks like there's only two certified manufacturers in the country and the other one's in California. So I'm guessing I know who this is from.
Business good, right? How much competition, right?
Yeah, well, they bought out everybody else. Good business sense.
So this will be funded with ODOT.
Yes.
Money, ODOT Office FAA money.
Yes, and that would be ODOT Office of Aviation funds 95% of the project. So our one and only bid is from DBT Transportation Services. And they have a bid price of $162,252.00. It looks like they've got their bid guarantee and everything else in here.
Was there an estimate on this, Brian?
Yes, the estimate was $180,000.
Okay.
So
Brian, we will turn that over to you. Is that how this works?
Yeah, we'll take this back and review it, make sure it's good. And
you'll go through it.
And then really at this point, all we have to do is get updated numbers to ODOT. As soon as they issue the PO, we can get them a contract and have them order the equipment. And that will probably be a little while. I think the last one we did, it took them about 6 months to get the system pulled together and out for delivery. So
this is a little bit like the jail and the juvenile center. I think we had to put a few $1,000 in it.
Yeah.
It needs replaced. We're getting it replaced. We just cross our fingers between now and then. You know, we don't have to do anything.
Yeah, we know that some of the components on the system, like
why you're up here,
kilometers, like $20,000 to replace it, and you can't even get the old ones anymore. You have to buy a used one and just hope it lasts. So
before you sit down and sit here, we do not
talk about the airport very often, especially at this kind of level. So we are, we have a 10-year trolling plan. We update it every year with the FAA. And those of you that lived in Seneca County a long time over the last 30-plus years, maybe 40, you've seen the airport houses get bought, trees getting torn down, drainage put in. We are now a regional airport, and since you're here, I was going to do this, but I'm going to have you just maybe a couple things. Explain the advantages of being a regional airport, and then what our plan is maybe over the next couple, 3 years, what we would like to do as far as with the county, our goals and with our federal money.
Yeah, so we've been the consultant for about 8 years, I think, and you know, in that time we've been here, we've resurfaced the taxiway, we've bought a couple properties, we're working on still buying some more properties. Two years ago, we got a grant to redo all the runway lighting on the runway and replace that with a new LED system. And we've got another ODOT grant for this weather station that we're working on now. So we're really, you know, making some progress out there on some of the maintenance type things. But one of the big things for the airport for a long time has been that, you know, the runway's not really the length that they need for the aircraft they'd like to bring in here. So we do have in the plans for the coming years, we're looking at a master plan update for the airport that would look at the existing conditions, the existing operations of aircraft and the fleet mix that's using the airport, and then come up with projections for what they see over the next 20 years. The FAA would use those numbers to identify what's a reasonable runway extension that they might be able to get out there to service those aircraft. Again, this will be a long, big master plan project, take multiple years. There'll be public meetings involved with that where people will be invited out for their input on it. But the commissioners will need to go through a consultant selection on that as well. The FAA requires that planning projects go through their own consultant selections. So they'll be looking to do that here in the near future. We're hoping to get a grant for that this year. And then we would expect in the course over the course of the next 2 to 3 years, they'll get that wrapped up and hopefully have the ability to extend the runway. I know most of the land that they would need for what they're looking for, you already, yeah, you've owned it for years.
You have State Route 53 on one side and the commissioners own the farm on the other side.
Yeah, so it's
trivia question, where's the extension going to be, north or south?
So, yeah. But anyway, it'll be a long process because, you know, the FAA gets very heavily involved in that. They, with good purpose, they don't want to fund extra infrastructure that isn't warranted. So I was just explaining to him before the meeting, one of the biggest, most important parts of that master plan project will be your future forecast for aircraft operations. And the FAA gets heavily involved in, you know, reviewing what the planner has done, what they've come up with, and identifying that they agree with that. So it'll be an interesting couple of years.
One final regional airport.
Oh yeah, so the airport is a general aviation airport. The FAA has years ago did a study that they call their asset study that classifies different general aviation airports based on the services, types of aircraft, and everything that they provide. And in years past, it didn't make a huge difference what category you fell in within there, and Seneca County had been a local airport in there. They have basic, local, regional, national on the general aviation. They had been local for the longest time. Didn't make a difference. Your funding was just general aviation. But with the infrastructure bill that was passed a few years ago, they have airport money that's available for general aviation airports, and the dollar amount varies across those different classifications. In the first year, you received $159,000 as a local airport, they've used it yet, but it's there, it can carry over for a few years to be lumped together. They were allotted $159,000. In between 2022 and 2023, the FAA did a reclassification of airports. Seneca County was reclassified as a regional airport. which is the upgrade in this instance made a huge difference because in 2023 and 2024, you were allotted roughly $295,000 a year instead of $159,000. So we've got a nice chunk of money that increased amount that is set aside just for Seneca County Airport through that infrastructure bill that we're looking to utilize in some of these future projects. So,
thank you, Brian. Any other questions, anybody?
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Welcome.
Always good to see you. You're wearing two hats today in the report.
Yes.
Thank you for coming.
Well, I have your names. And I guess I have one for you as well. And I feel like you don't get the one, but I have.
Turn the floor over to you, okay?
Okay.
You
got it, buddy. Good morning. Mircea Handru with the Mental Health Recovery Service Board. It's just my annual update about the board and the services we provide. I included the annual report that we do every year. It's also on our website in electronic form. But I would also like to talk about the One Ohio Recovery Foundation. Seneca County Commissioners last week appointed me to Region 17 to represent Seneca County on the One Ohio Recovery Foundation board. Region 17 is made out of 8 counties in Northwest Ohio. And those 8 counties also selected me to be the representative on the foundation board at the state level. Exciting news that I have about that is the foundation that will manage 55% of the opioid lawsuit for the state of Ohio, 55% of the funds. The really exciting news is that next week, Monday, on March 4th, the first RFP, the request for funds will be live on One Ohio Recovery Foundation website. So again, the first pot of money is ready to be bid out. So agencies can go and read all the requirements that we have put together and worked really hard for the last year or so to develop. Another exciting news that I have is that there will be a lot of online or Zoom sessions for agencies to know how to apply for these funds, and it can be private or public entities. Private can include for-profit or non-for-profit. But the exciting news is they want to do a few listening sessions in person across the state of Ohio. And we just committed April 22nd, they will come to Tiffin for a listening session. So that's really nice. We just confirmed that. April 22nd, NCOESC application deadline is due early May. So you don't really have a lot of time. So you probably want to read before you come to the April 22nd meeting ahead and kind of get a game plan together. A lot of programs, I believe, in Seneca County will qualify for these funds. Again, you will have to be in relationship to the opioid epidemic, mental health, and so on. You can't really bid on an airport project for these funds, correct? But you can bid on, again, education, prevention, treatment, and recovery support services. So really, that's our my One Ohio update. We'll probably have the regional meeting the same day on the 22nd. Kayla and Zach, we are willing to meet with the local media if needed right after our in-person listening session. We will have people from the foundation come back to Seneca County for the training. As I mentioned, we have the annual report, but I do also want to highlight the recovery housing that we really developed and have been pretty successful in Seneca County, and it's included in your package. We have them on our website now. All the information about our recovery houses, it's on our website. All the application is done electronically, so individuals who maybe don't have a computer home or a laptop can do it from their phone or the library, or they can do it from the Seneca County Jail if needed, correct, if they are looking for a place after they are being released. So all the information about what we do and what we don't do or what are the expectations are on our website. Tells you exactly how many individuals are in each house, what is the client rent portion per week, and a little bit about the house rules. We are also excited to say that we are planning to open 2 male recovery homes also this year. We really hope that the one will be able to take applications tomorrow, but unfortunately we ran into a snag last night, a little bit with the inspection. So we have to fix a few things. But we're really hoping in the next 30 days or so to be able to get applications for the Mayor Recovery House that is here in Tiffin. And we are also working on closing a deal to purchase a home by June 30th as well. So They will give two May recovery homes, Seneca County residents, an option for that as well.
Nice.
I don't know if you guys have any questions. I wasn't really, again, Daniel report, it's available for everybody on the website. Just highlights a few things that they will eat throughout the years, who are our 18 board members from the four counties, some of the services, and more a little bit about our annual budget. So really excited about that. We had a really, very good year in 23. We renew a levy in Sandusky County, which is good. Just for the public to know, we have levies for each county, but each levy is county specific. So we will not mix money from Sandusky County to Seneca County or the other way around. We do have a levy this November in Ottawa County, so we've got to keep campaigning. But Sandusky County was extremely successful, passed the highest rate in the state of Ohio of any mental health levy renewal. So
70-30 or something?
We're close to 75, 74, 73%, yes. So that was really good. You guys have any questions? Boy, anything?
Wow. Yeah, just amazing what you do. Fantastic job. I mean, that's, you know, especially run as many counties as you cover. That's amazing.
Appreciate it.
It's a major issue right now. People need help.
Didn't you tell me one time we haven't raised the taxes?
Well, it's kind of unique because I know...
And somehow you keep running with the money you have, right? And that's where the grants and everything come in.
It's kind of unique, I believe, from a public entity. A few years ago, we actually reduced the millage of our levies, which you don't really hear about it. When you see all the public entities trying to always ask for more, so we actually reduced our millage in all of our three counties a few years ago. I believe one of our successful is the federal grants that we apply for and are very aggressive. We receive actually another 4-year federal grant, then it's a very large grant, $4 million. We are just being very aggressive with federal funds and try to match that. And it covers for some of our staffing and some of the obviously services and programs that we do. So just to give an idea, 10 years ago, well, our budget was around $3.5 million. Today we are around $11.5 million.
The tax rate
didn't increase.
The same.
Correct. The property tax levy stayed the same or went down in all of our counties.
It's impressive.
So I think that should be noted to the taxpayers. Not only are you providing tremendous services to the county, but you're doing a great job fiscally and managing that department. And we appreciate that. Definitely. Thank you. Anything else? Does anybody want to add anything?
Yeah.
Or a photo?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, you mind? You got
him. It's fine. I'm, nice. Hey, I'm dressed.
Yeah. You look pretty nice. Well, we have you come up.
Yeah. Hey, Deke, we already got Deke. Yeah. These one of our board members from Seneca County, come in the picture.
Okay. Here
I am. D. Franker.
You've been a Frankert all your life.
I have, right?
I've only been
two Frankerts in the same room.
Right, that's scary, isn't it?
Yeah, it is scary.
I've only been one for 49 years.
That was a good one, by the way.
What's that?
Oh, wait. You've been a Frankert all your life.
Yeah, not all my life, but smile.
Thank you.
Appreciate
it.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks, Phil.
Yeah. You take off, Mary. Go.
Okay.
Bring steak.
Yep, you're good. I know you have work to do, buddy. Thank you very much for the update. Just when we think you can't get any better, you keep getting better. So
thank you.
We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay, so Bryce is here. This would be a good opportunity for you to come on up.
Yeah.
You're wearing a Visitor Bureau hat.
Visitor Bureau hat today. Yeah, so I know John's here as
Where's
well.
Where's Marissa?
She's back at the office. Well, one of us has to work, right?
Yeah, so John's here. John's here. EMA, so you have the floor, buddy.
Yep, so I will just, a quick update. We're 39 days away from the April 8th total solar eclipse. And we had some really good meetings this week. I know John's had a lot of meetings throughout the county over the last year, but we had about 200 people plus. At three different meetings at North Central Ohio Educational Service Center, the Foster Learning Center, and then also at Seneca East. That was on Monday. And so it was really informative. We had John, we had EMA, We had the Foster Aid Chamber announcing TSAP, and FEDC and our other partners were in the room as well, just providing some insight to our partners about, you know, best practices. From the business standpoint, I think that's the biggest thing, is that from a chamber slash visitors bureau, it's kind of some, you know, businesses like, okay, what are best practices, ensuring that our employees remain safe, that we remain safe, and that our community really can enjoy this experience. And so a lot of things planned with that. We've had, there's a CLIPS committee that's been meeting about every month. I just kind of go through some things. And I think right now I counted, we have over 20 events planned right now throughout the weekend, which was really exciting. We actually got a call yesterday from the Toledo Green, and they noted that, you know, of all the counties in Northwest Ohio, we seem to be the most active in terms of this experience. And so for us, that's really cool. And she compared us to Bowling Green and others, and W2L has also said the same as well. So we're just really excited about it. Obviously, the big thing is SenecaCountySolarEclipse.com has information about, you know, best practices. John also on his website has best practices for our community and businesses. But, you know, I think we always said, you know, the eclipse is, that's next year, that's next year, that's next year. Well, 39 days away. And the big thing is, as John has, you know, really been preaching, plan. But obviously, like any other plan, things will change, and things will, you know, we need to be able to be a little more flexible. I mean, a lot of residents still have a lot of questions about, you know, how do we remain safe. But I can tell you from, we have like right now 70 people signed up for the 5K standpoint. Our new community guide went to print yesterday, which will be done in earlier this year to be ready for the solar eclipse. And then we have 120 weddings that are booked with about 14,000 miles traveling to Seneca County. I said the story, we had a woman call. We're now wedding planners in our professions. We had a woman call on last Friday. Her grandson didn't give her enough information, so naturally she called her office to get additional information. But they're bringing in 25 people from South Carolina to watch the grandson get married on that day. So we're sending out save the dates for the wedding. They are ordered, they're going out early next week, and then we have like a kind of online flipping book about logistics and all those things, parking, to hopefully alleviate some of the concerns with kind of a larger group. But a lot going on with that, and then obviously the bicentennial we met yesterday, so some things planned with that. Tyler was on W2L yesterday and with Marissa about the beard contest that's kind of going on as well. And then the April 1st.
You got one started?
I know, I'm working on it. You too, Tony. Yeah. Tyler, maybe you'll work on it. Bill, I got some time right now.
I threw the towel in.
Exactly. And then April 1st is the big kickoff event at the museum. We've reached out to all the dignitaries throughout the state of Ohio. I think we're going to have a representative from every office that will be there for that. Really looking forward to promoting our county for both the eclipse and the bicentennial. And then everything else we work on as well. Things are exciting in our office, and they never slow down. We're going to South Bend, Indiana tomorrow, the entire weekend, to work on some bus tour traffic for the Heartland Travel Showcase. We've seen probably a fairly significant increase in bus tour traffic over the last couple of years. That was a big Carol Yeager thing back in the day that we've continued and really brought that back into our community. So thanks to the commissioners for all their assistance as well.
You know, this is a paradigm where we have EMA here, we expect 150,000 people, and it's all about, we're closing offices and safety and public services, but we also realize we have all these people here, so we're turning it into a tourism fun event showcasing our county. And again, you know, with safety, and everybody's working together to control this, because many of those people are coming anyhow to see the eclipse. So while they're here, they can have some fun, do some things, spend some money in our county. So I think I just commend both of you for everything you're doing and promoting the county. And it's just kind of a neat thing, mm-hmm. really.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
You know, but we're at a very high level, right, John, with EMA. With fire departments, police, EMS, everything.
It's crucial.
Working together, so.
So it's gonna be a good weekend for lodging tax,
yeah.
And a good weekend for sales tax, so we're excited about that. You win, we win, and that's the biggest thing.
You guys have done a great job, yeah. Anything you wanna add?
No, I think it says a lot. I mean, if WTOL and Toledo's taking notice down here of all the things we have going on, and saying that we're being the most active, We're beating the drum the hardest, so kudos to our team.
120 ways, Martha Stewart.
Yeah,
we have outside of that, just the whole country. I mean,
national. Adam, you didn't know this, Brian, but 120 people are getting married at the three. What time is it?
It's 3:11.
3:11.
Are they going to fly in?
Zero for the eclipse.
We joked at Hardin County and Mercer County. We're like, well, we just hope we don't do all this planning and then get overcast rainy day.
Yeah. Well, in our case, we're just like, I hope we get those people here. The big thing I think is cool is that WTOL, for example, they're going to be in town Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday, and they're going to be doing a live remote basically throughout the whole week. And so a lot of other, obviously, community organizations, when this is all said and done, they're going to do features on other organizations while they're here. And then throughout Northwest Ohio, they're going to live cast the wedding. So not only do you get to marry your significant other in the dark, the rest of Northwest Ohio get to watch you as well. But just hopefully marry the right person when it goes dark. technically you are getting married in the
right, aren't you? Yeah.
We've had a few people reach out to us. I won't name names, Tyler, but you know,
I'm just kidding. Allison.
You're not married yet either.
You're good. So.
But you know, that's a good point. So there'll be clips that will continue after this. Feature stories.
We actually ended up booking this chandelier as an after space because the big thing is, right, again, come early, stay late. We're hoping that people go to the chandelier. We'll do the wedding cake there. We'll do the toast there. And then we've, T-Town DJ is going to have his DJ stuff set up there. And then a lot of people have jumped in. We've got some photographers that have jumped in as part of it because, and the nice thing is everyone's offering their services for free because it's going to create a better experience for everyone. And hopefully we get people back. And, you know, hopefully you get married, you stay married, and then you want to come back every year for your anniversary trip. And that's our big thing. We have some stuff planned for the following years to get people to come back. And that's the big thing.
I think it's great. Yeah, someone could go back, you know, just for, yeah, even as they're, been married and stuff on it. Just for reiterating some on it, hopefully.
So one, and then we'll move on, but before you go, let's talk about the bicentennial real quick.
Yep.
So, Commissioner Shelf has kind of taken over that committee for the commissioners, but April 1st is the 200th birthday of Seneca County, and we are having an event 10 in the morning down at the museum, as Bryce alluded to. But it's the events and the celebration of the bicentennial will be throughout the entire year. It's not going to be 10 o'clock, Tiffin's 200, and we never talk about it again. So that's basically the kickoff, right, and the launch of a series of events that are being planned. The logo, all the little villages, the little museums, the little gems hid throughout the county that nobody knows about or forgot about will be rolled out fair. There's some events that'll be taking place. Is that a fair statement?
Yeah. So, like, for example, the kickoffs. April 1st.
And
then we have the Canine Commissioner Beer Contest. We have the Tourist in Your Own Town, which will be later in April, where all the museums in the county will open up for at no cost, which will be nice. And then, we also the Heritage Festival. We have a representative now on that committee with the Heritage Festival. I know we've had Lisa reach out from the Public Tree Fair, Bloomville, others. And so the biggest thing is the incorporation of all these entities to come together because, again, it's an opportunity to celebrate our history, but it's another opportunity to bring people together. And then really, again, I think the more PR, the people we can get out to the different events, it's a huge experience for us. And it's been kind of cool, like I said, the W2L picked up the beard contest, but we've had other people reach out to us about different things as well throughout the year.
Coming back to the eclipse a little bit, I know there. Have you reached back out to Alan Eichholz with Attica? Have you guys communicated?
I just talked to him 2 days. So we talked to him, and then provided all the information. So he saw that he was on the places, the camping spots on the overall Destination Seneca County page. Once I gave him the information, the county thing. And that's something else that Pluto Blade mentioned. The amount of camping spots we have available is a lot more than any other community around us. The big thing I would just continue to push is that with most of our hotels booked up, right? A lot of these individuals have kind of gone out on a limb to open up their facilities, whether it be the Seneca County Fairgrounds, the Attica Fairgrounds, all these different properties, Elmer Cole. And so our biggest thing is that we want to make sure people stay there. And I know it's been kind of slow going for some of those folks. And our big thing is if you're looking to bring family in from out of town, maybe you don't want to be with them for a few days, Maybe you just send out to, you know, maybe Kiefer's property or somebody else's property, because again, it's another opportunity to experience it. Because for example, Elmer's Cole's property is really right in the center line, in the heart of it all. There's not going to be a better view than that. And I will say that other communities we've worked with, they're kind of a lot of someone noted that a lot of every county around us has just like maybe one or two events planned, and a lot of them are kind of saying, hey, like, look, we're not, you know, we're not trying to make this a big deal, but for us, it's like, you know, it's a fun thing to do, bring people together and to remember it, because next time we'll have a solar eclipse and hopefully we'll all be dead, so we won't be around, so let's make sure we enjoy it.
We're doing a great job. We appreciate it.
Yeah, I tell you,
you're doing a good job.
You're out of the park with that.
John, you want to add anything at this point?
No, just a reminder that next Tuesday morning, 9 o'clock, we'll be talking about the eclipse communications plan at the Public Safety Building. Okay. And that reminder email went out before I came here, so.
Okay. I'd like to go with that, thank you.
Good. You say it's tomorrow morning?
Next Tuesday morning.
Yep. Okay, yep. Yeah. Did you just add the law in on this past Tuesday?
Yep. Correct? Yep.
Okay. And then is, did I hear the mobile unit for the sheriff's going to be maybe out there 19 and 224?
Yes. Yeah. He said that they were going to put their mobile unit out there, and we're mapping right now where we're going to have intersections manned to try and keep the boxes open between the sheriff's office, Tiffin Police Department, and CERT. We'll have people managing those intersections as best they can.
Good. Thank you, Bryce.
I hope. Hope people embrace this, because I think like the Chamber and TSEP and FED, everybody's, we're always trying to have marketing events, the third Thursday events, we're always trying to figure out how to get people here. Mother Nature's going to bring them here, so embrace it, be prepared, be safe, and just stay calm. I mean, traffic's going to be a little heavier, we'll deal with it, just I'm going to it with a positive attitude. I hope the community does so.
Thank you.
Good.
Thank you.
Okay, commissioner reports. I'd like to go first. I'm going to pick on John and Barb right now. We had a nice EMS meeting out at the Public Safety Building. Was that yesterday or the day? Yesterday. So with Dr. Sauer?
Yesterday.
We met with the medical director. We had a good meeting on communication and education. So we're trying to develop an education plan system for all our employees that work EMS. We're excited about our remote locations, right? The new facility on 224, the new facility that'll be built on County Road 6 has high-speed fiber, or will have high-speed fiber. So these kind of things, you know, start to pop up, and they start to do Zoom training, and Dr. Sauer can dial in from Toledo and talk to us. So we commissioned John, he didn't know it at the time, but we commissioned John and Barb to maybe upgrade that room with a little more of this kind of, a little more technology. We have some things in there, right, John, but it's not conducive to like Google, Google School or Google, it's like Google School. You can have training and so that's kind of exciting. So yeah, while we're out there at EMA in our public building, that big room really has some technology upgrades, but it needs to kind of go to the next level. Shouldn't be a whole lot of money, but John's going to kind of head that up and help, you know, turn that room into an education room, a training room that really will give us access everywhere, including out to our remote locations, which would be great. And then they can have the echoes, everybody can train right there, Doc can get in, volunteers can dial in from home at their convenience, because it's sometimes, you know, you're at home. But I was pretty excited about that, so appreciate taking that on, working with Barb. And
I do have a question on that, Tony.
Yeah.
So as far as the training, there's been some between volunteers. Everybody's going to be kind of getting the same training.
Everybody's on the same level
then. Okay.
Absolutely. 100% same level.
Same level. Good.
Yeah. Good. Seneca County aspires at this level. Our medical director wants us at this level. It doesn't matter if you're a volunteer, if you're advanced paid paramedic. You're all expected to know the basic protocols and have certain standards of training. A lot of that is, the way this is going to work is that we have right now three people. We will have very soon three employees that are certified trainers that will fall under Dr. Sovereign. He'll let them, if you're having a problem with an IV, let's say, they can go out and they can spend one-on-one time with somebody to improve IV or airways, or it's just good internal constant training. We need to be at the top of our game, you know, and I really think that's what's also making us better and distinctive, and because, you know, that's when you work for us, and you know, we pay for the training, but we require the training, right? And you're going to stay on top of it, and it's really a good thing. Is that, you want to add anything, Bart? Because you were out there.
No, it's just Dr. Sovereign very invested in the education of our people to make sure that we have the highest standard we can possibly have across the board.
And not only holding the standards, but this technology and the internal training allows flexibility. You know, so if you're a volunteer over in the neuro area and you work all day and you can't make it Saturday morning to this class, you can take the video course. You can zoom in from home. He's all about that.
Great.
Yeah. Yeah. So we want to tie this all together. And those guys out there know how to run it. Just so you know, yeah. They're
none of us fumbling around.
Yeah, we're just like, John, you put it in, and then we'll let right. All those EMS people operate it. But yeah, it's pretty exciting. So I just want the public to know that, and you guys to know that, and those are the little things you don't think that people don't really realize that we're doing. So I wanted to get that out there. Alan, that's my report. So you want to go next, Mitch?
Yeah, sure.
We'll let Abe blink and wait till last. How's that, Abe?
Yeah, that's good. No, just kind of add to or piggyback on what Commissioner Paradiso was talking about. I don't think the public understands how much time these two and the group as a whole, especially you two, but put into EMS and stuff. Starting down this road a few years ago, a lot of people said this wouldn't come together, and it just, where we were a few years ago and where it's at now, it's rolling in the right direction. So just wanted people to know that, because we don't give daily, weekly updates, but
yeah.
you two have handled this very well. As Bryce kind of alluded to earlier, we had a bicentennial meeting that was yesterday at the museum. We got the bicentennial coming up and the eclipse, so it's going to be a busy month and a half here for the commissioner's office. So good things planned for that. Appreciate all the hard work that Teresa Sullivan's put in and just the group as a whole. Also was on WTOL here this week talking about the beard contest. They picked it up, I think, from the chamber site or destination, but and it came down to a short little story on that. Marissa went on, and it was actually a pretty fun interview. It was via Zoom, and I think they edited a few things out of there, which is probably good, but it was a fun interview. Say the least.
Marissa on there. Yeah.
She's a comedian.
I'm sorry. Yeah. A couple of her comments, I guess. And internal meeting here in the office this week, just going over projects, and we go through our initiatives, and Barb keeps us all straight, and we kind of help guide her as well, but just kind of have some discussions here on projects and upcoming stuff, so it's good to have those meetings and discuss things. Also worked through some land bank issues here this week. I have a few potential projects or business developments that are going to be possibly happening through the land bank, but just trying to make sure everybody's paddling in the same direction as far as those go. Busy week in the office this week, getting caught up on emails and stuff. I'll be out for a few days, which you guys know, but no, all in all, things are going good. So,
good.
Short report.
Good.
Yep.
Great.
Yes, sir. So last Thursday, went to the Board of Health. They had their meeting. Kind of a long one. They used an executive session for quite a while, but I think they're kind of getting a scope on a direction that they're moving with on, with landfill and all the other stuff that they have to, we kind of work with them on landfill quite a bit, but they do have another site that, they have to pay a lot of attention to, from restaurants to septic systems to you know, health yeah. and all that. So, I mean, it's just, we get a lot of stuff thrown at them, and, you know, it's, I think Julie's really hit the ground running there, so, you know, the new commissioner stuff. She's been there 6-7 months now and had a lot thrown at her right out of the gate. You know, had to move right away
doing,
and stuff with it.
Great.
So, I think it's, yeah, they're coming together good and yeah, moving in a good direction there. So, Friday night, was over to the Greater Fostoria Community Foundation fundraiser. Great event over at Stacy's place there, and you know, it was a good attendance. I, you know, the tables were pretty well filled and stuff on it, and they did a fantastic job there and stuff with it. And those who weren't there, you could, Zach was up leading the line dance and stuff there with everybody. So,
how's come that picture wasn't?
You're right, just that picture there, Zach, yeah. So, and then Monday, you know, with Bryce and John and Health Department doing the Eclipse meetings at Barbara and I was out to the NCOES meeting at 9, and I couldn't get enough, so I went over to Fostoria too and listened to it. So I just to show the support from the county that we have from one end of the county to the other. That's and good. Stuff on it. I had a another meeting that night, otherwise I would have went up to Santa Keys and stuff. I'd have to sound like, you know, what I seen at Tiffin and Fostoria, you know, a few more people maybe would have thought even come. So I had a great, great job on the slideshows and giving the presentation and stuff with it. So, so as I alluded to, Monday night, went over to Loudoun Township to their zoning meeting, and the zoning board at the end of it passed their proposal. Which goes to trustees now for zoning in Loudoun Township. So the trustees will accept it then if they choose to, and then they'll have to put on a ballot then in August to be on a November election. Then.
Loudoun does not have zoning.
Loudoun does not have zoning.
Or one of our townships, yeah.
Yeah, there's okay. been, you know, kind of, you know, figuring out. It's quite a, you know, process to go through and stuff with it, and they really spent a lot of time, and, you know, as things go, you think this should be this and that, and the guidance from, you know, with Derek and Jack and stuff on that, they really, you know, got moved on and stuff with it. So they really deep dive in. And, I mean, that's, those are all, you know, volunteers taking time out of schedule for 3-4 hour meetings. I mean, again, that night, it, you know, started at 6:30 and left at 8:30. They was just moving in executive session. So, I mean, I think it was 9:30, 10 o'clock they got done. So people that want to step up and do this, you know, support the community, I think it's fantastic. And, you know, a lot of unsung heroes out there, that's for sure. Tuesday, had an interview with Channel 13. Great interview. We had actually Kathy came in talk about what with her building plans, what she's wanted to see out the job and family services, and that aired. And you know, I think that picked up some nice traction and stuff with it. I think that you know, as we said, we're supporting that once they, you know, get everything kind of put together and see where we end up at with it. So Wednesday, went over to had a. Kind of a museum meeting, met with Teresa, John Huss, Mayor Wilkerson, Nick Dutrow, Chief Chapel. There's been some question on the items there at the museum, whose are they, what are they, and Barb reached out to Derek and got some great information and took it down, and so I think everybody's on the same page that, you know, that where it's going to stay and be there as we progress. I think there could be some cleaning up and some making some official documentation stuff. It's just been over time, you know, just, you know, things get donated and just, you know, paperwork gets shuffled around. I think the Adriatic, you know, John did some research on that, and actually was donated to the museum in 1942 or whatever from the family.
It was at that museum since 42. They've had it before that.
They've had it before that, and it was, yeah, donated there since 42, so it's been in the possession of the museum since that. So they really, got a big challenge having. They're working through sorting things and figuring out. I mean, it just doesn't happen overnight. They're getting ready for the bicentennial, so a lot going on at the museum. They do an outstanding job, you know, with that. So kudos to them down there. Spent a lot of time with that. So we'll be working, you know, again with City Tiffin now that they know the scope. You know, looking about doing a maybe a facility there. Working on some prints for that, and I think once that comes out, they well aware of what's going on with it now. So. And yesterday afternoon, I was on a Zoom meeting. Treasurer Sprague hosted. I think it's a fantastic program that they've introduced a few weeks ago, maybe a month by now, but it's called the Home Buyer Plus Program. So it's for Basically, anybody that's 18 years and older, it's a program you work with your banks, and it's such a new program that I think the banks around here are starting to figure out what it is and try to get the paperwork submitted. But it's kind of like a savings account for if you want to use it to purchase a house. So what you do is that you can start out with $100 up to $100,000, you can put an account, and then whatever their interest rate is for like a CD, the state is backing up with, as of today, now it changes quarterly, but a 2.59 on top of that. So for example, if you get a CD at 4%, they're adding another 2.59 to it, so you can get a 6.5 return on your money sitting in there, and then you pull it out when you want to purchase a home. Not only a first time home, but if you want to buy a second home, but it's not, you have to live in it. So it's not like you can do it for rentals or anything like that. Mm-hmm. But if you want to do that, I think it's a fantastic program for kids and stuff on that to just start throwing some money into that. Great. So 10 years from now, they have a nice little nest egg to, you know, utilize it. So, yeah, so that's exciting, and stay tuned as we get more. And I think Pat McCauley would probably be up and maybe give some presentation mm-hmm. stuff, but I did circle around with him a little bit. So. That brings up today, so.
Good. The we've been talking, the museum for 10 years, we've been talking about taking inventory, excuse me, and cataloging everything that's in there. I lost my voice. Excuse me. And they've made tremendous progress. They obviously haven't gotten to the fire stuff yet, but this will be, this all makes sense. Mm-hmm. So. Good job. You're up.
Yep. Yeah, just one quick comment just here on the museum. I remember, I don't know, 7-8 years ago when I was on city council, there was discussions of selling the museum, or there was financial hardship, and they were talking about selling the items in the museum, and I just remember those discussions were pretty disheartening, just seeing where the situation it was in. Yeah. 6, 7, 8 years ago to where it is now, just night and day difference, and just makes a big difference. When you have the right people running things, and just I'm glad to see where we're at with the museum right now, because it was a little stressful a few years back.
Good. Old business?
Can I move back to taking a motion to approve the minutes of the last meeting?
So moved.
Second.
Accept the motion to approve the digital audit reporting of our last meeting, February 22nd. We have a first and a second.
We really got off on one. No, I'll keep
it here. I'm just trying to keep us, you know, the way we should be. So,
roll call.
Commissioner Frankert?
Yes.
Commissioner Schuff?
Yes.
Commissioner Paradiso?
Yes.
Okay.
That was good.
So, okay. Then I'll
that is old business, though.
Well, we technically it is. I'm going to do my administrator's report, please, before we do old business.
Okay.
Just a reminder that tomorrow is the luncheon at the School of Opportunity Center at 11:30. I believe the two of you, Tony and Bill, are attending. I am also going to attend that just to better support understand them. What's going on out there.
Great.
We have possibly a conflict of timing with the Fostoria Economic Development and Chamber of Commerce for Fostoria. Their annual meeting falls on Thursday, March 21st at 8 a.m. in Fostoria. Obviously, Thursday is our board meeting day, so I would maybe suggest that we move our meeting back, or we change the day that we meet or something, so that you know, you guys don't have to cut out early from that, because that's usually a pretty good meeting.
Yeah, I don't want to leave during the middle of their presentation. That'd be
so
rude.
I just want to bring it up for discussion, and I mean, we can move the meeting to a different day, or we'll just go to 11 o'clock. And
can you make it back?
Oh, yeah, like it'll be good. Yeah,
okay. So that's just kind of one of my housekeeping things. The other thing I would like to just make mention, Vicki Johnson at the AT, her last day with the AT is tomorrow. There was an article in the paper yesterday. I just would like to say thank you for all of the, you know, writings that she's done for us, and, you know, the support of the reporter.
Anything add to that, Vicki?
It's gonna be strange to see Vicky gone. She's been there since I started, which was only 4 years ago. So with her leaving, I'm now the senior reporter at the UT, and I haven't even reached 4 years, so that's very intimidating. But we're gonna miss her. I'm gonna miss her guidance and her help. She was always quick to, if I couldn't make it to something, like she's taken my place many times and many things. So it's gonna be strange to see her gone, but she's kind of moving on to her retirement days, and she's got a lot of passion she wants to pursue, so I'm happy for her, but we'll miss her for sure.
I think she gets in a lot in the reenactment
stuff.
Yeah,
she does.
That's
great.
What I think she really loves doing that. So.
I'm glad you brought that up.
Bryce, how many years has she been there?
I don't know if this article
I don't know how many times she's left. I know kind of everybody has had their times they've left, but I want to say she's been there. And Vicky, if you're listening to this, don't get mad. I think she's been there about 30 years.
Yeah, like that kind of, I think it's in that range.
I want to say in her editorial that she did, she said she started at the AT, like at right after college. So she's been there a long time.
1980s, it says in the article.
She's been there since I was in elementary or middle
school. 1980s.
Okay. Yeah. So almost.
So she's been there.
Kayla, you're on the fast track to upper
management. But she's done a very nice job. I saw it in the newspaper yesterday, and I just thought I would send out kudos to her and congratulations to her. So.
Yeah.
Thank you. Next time. Yeah. Okay.
That's all I have for administrator report.
I do, Ed. Why don't we maybe get a proclamation set up for her? Let's have her come in sometime. Sorry about that. There's something down there,
jump, Bill, okay. Jump.
Yep.
we're all feeling it now since you brought it up. So that thank you. Yeah. Very respected, very grateful. Old business, you have one thing and I have one thing.
Yeah.
Okay. Then we're just about finished.
Do you want me to go first?
You go first.
Okay. Just a couple of quick comments on the public safety building improvements. We're gonna try to take place. I had John take down all the flags out there. They were starting to be torn and tattered, and I believe John has new ones to go back up. But we're going to wait to put them back up because we are going to pressure wash and paint the building. So we're trying to get that taken care of before the 1st of April, but it may be April at some point because weather. Weather and all of that. But I believe that we are first on the list. Damon Paint's going to do the painting for us, so I believe we're first on the list. So as soon as they can get out there, they're going to pressure wash, and then the building will get two coats of paint, and then we'll get the flags put back up. There was a gate for the fence that needed to be replaced or repaired. That's been taken care of. We're working on privacy slats for the chain link fence. As soon as that comes in, John's going to work with the sheriff's office to get the work crew out there to get that taken care of. And then we're going to work with the fairgrounds, the company that's going to do some of the asphalt work out there. We've got a quote in about $26,000 to repave our section of the parking lot out there, or driveway. So we're going to get that taken care of as well. Hopefully have it all done before the fair so that it's all, you know, we're all good, spruced up for that. So that's I just wanted to bring you guys all up to speed on that.
What kind of paint are we using?
Damon's
masonry.
I would assume they know what
Damon's
they're doing. There's a quote somewhere. I think it's
Sherman Wood. I think it's the top of the line.
Yeah, it's a good paint. It's not something that's going to flake off in a year and a half or anything like that.
It's hard. Masonry's tricky sometimes.
Yeah, they're going to pressure wash the building, and then it's going to be at least two coats of paint on the building. Probably,
I get that. Are they going to go through and like caulk and just tighten? Because I know
believe they're tightening up some of the areas. I would have to go back and I didn't pull that quote, but I'm pretty sure that's going to happen. They're going to tighten up the building out there.
So there's times where you're inside the building, you can see pale and out the other. So like, let's tighten it up.
We'll get that all taken care of.
I'm just before we do it. I'm just.
Yep.
John, there's there are two, I was out there this morning, there are two amateur radio signs up that are kind of faded, one to the left of the tower and one around back, I think, or there's some sort, you know, those little white signs?
Yeah.
You might want to get with that group and get new signs.
Sure.
And just, we'll take them down, paint everything, and then they can put up something new. I think that would look good. The other thing, I just had an aha moment as we fixed this up. We talked about this yesterday. But EMS now, that's central headquarters for Seneca County EMS, for the public safety building. And there are a lot of events there in that lower room. We have training, people come in there. So that's an added benefit of showcasing that building and being proud of that's a county facility, you know.
Civil defense building.
Yeah. Vicki and I are old enough.
Yeah.
We used to go to the nuclear showers with the yellow signs and go down and you guys don't remember that. Anything else, old business?
No.
Mr. Brian Baugh, he remembers those days. The nuclear threat days. Oh yeah.
The Ozzy Osbourne siren going on.
You finished?
Yep.
I want to bring up one more thing. John, if you have to go, take off. You're not going to offend me. I was approached by Rotary, and I met with Keith Hawkinson and Ann Lang. I believe Ann's the president or past president of Rotary. They've been talking about this for a couple years. I think it's in 2025 is their 100-year anniversary of Seneca County as a service club. They want to do an AHA project, so I went to the meeting and met with them. They have a compelling project. It would be a clock similar to what you see in Heidelberg, companies out of Cincinnati. Be an awesome clock. They want to put it on the court. They've asked if they could put it on the courthouse property, the square of the lawn there. They would provide maintenance. They would do this. They would, you know. So it was a good presentation. They were also told by somebody that there was a courthouse square committee that was established back when. I think this started when I was here. I know it started when I was here. You actually had a couple of meetings. Because at that point, we had a request for a Martin Luther King statue to be put on the courthouse square. We had a lot of discussions. You know, should we designate a little area, let these kind of things happen? You know, when you look at it, other than the Gibson statue and the historical plaque, the two first women in the state of Ohio attorneys, there's nothing else on the courthouse lawn. So it's a big deal, and I said I would bring it up. Okay, I did some research before the meeting to see if the commissioners had formally passed a resolution establishing a courthouse square committee, and
we
can't find one, so we don't think we have a formal resolution having a formal committee. And this committee was discussed to maybe meet twice a year, take applications, and then make a recommendation to the commissioners. So at that point, no action was taken. We don't really have a courthouse square committee established. So I don't know what you guys are thinking as to what we would do next as far as this request. Any comments from either of you? I'm just bringing the request up.
Sure. I guess kind of where I'm at with it, that, you know, I think their intentions are great. I think, you know, it is Rotary, but pretty soon, what other organization, and you know, are we going to keep putting stuff on the, and take up the green space? I mean, the courthouse to me is, you know, part of the ambiance of the courthouse is the green grass, the yard, and I mean, when there's events downtown, it gives people, you know, places to kind of hang out, and
do some things at. You know, that's, I guess, kind of where I'm at. You know, we talk about maintenance and stuff on it. We all know what ends up, and then we end up, you know, dealing with stuff happens at the clock, and we're having trouble keeping our clock out of courthouse, you know, lined up right and stuff with it. And, you know, that's.
Did they bring that up that they would, yeah, they would do the maintenance? But sure. I mean, yeah, okay, right. So. Well, we'll, I mean, see what it, this what commission
and I guess maybe something, if we're doing something in the museum, maybe that might be a good spot to put, you know, something to that effect, maybe not a cup, but something too. So I think we've got some other avenues and stuff potentially, but.
Other than the courthouse.
Yeah, that's, you just don't want to start cluttering it up, in my opinion. Again, that's.
What I don't want to do is see these different groups and stuff, not want to participate and do these kind of projects, because I think they're great, but we have a lot of other spaces throughout the city and the county that we can put these things. I guess with the courthouse space, what we do for one group, we're going to have to do for all the groups. So if Rotary does one, Qantas is going to want to do one. If we do one statue of one, somebody else is going to want a statue. And how do we say, hey, you know what, we allowed it for this one and not for this group? I guess what I don't want to see is the courthouse square turn into a cluster, a long chain of different monuments and stuff. I love these projects. I think they're fantastic. But I think right now with what we have up there, let's keep it clean, clear, and crisp. Nothing against these groups for coming up with these ideas. I think they're great, but we have a lot of really cool spots that we can put these. The clock's awesome. I'm sure it's going to be fantastic. We have a clock on the top of the tower, so maybe we can put it in a part of town that would be better served. So keep coming with these projects and the groups. We love what you're doing, but I guess my stance would be let's keep the courthouse square, green and clear and clean.
That's where you're at. That's where I'm at.
Yeah, so I talked to Derek, the prosecutor, and he said, you know, you're the commissioners. You can put anything on there you want. But he goes, remember, commissioners after you can tear it down. So it's one of those things, you know, and you're seeing that in the country. Statues are coming down, so we could, yeah, that's good. And down the road, a group of commissioners would say, we don't like that. So, yeah, I've thought about this since they came to him, so I'm listening to you guys. I think that's my position too, is that we just don't do anything on the courthouse. So I've thought about it. Do we resurrect this courthouse committee? Do we take applications? I think if we just say, since it's not official, we don't have a formal, right? We don't have any formal entity, so it's basically up to us whether, and I don't want to pick and choose. It's a great project. I appreciate them asking us, but I'm kind of like, so I think we're officially saying, unofficially saying, we're going to leave the courthouse alone. And so next week when somebody comes, and the following week, and next year, it's going to be pretty much the same answer.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep.
You know, at least as long as we're here.
I think it'd be opening a can of worms.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We've got plenty of spaces to put these things. If somebody wants to put a past president, that's controversial. And if somebody wants to put a cross, yeah, or
know,
it just,
I know.
It can get out of hand really quick.
I appreciate it. I will call them back after the meeting and let them know that, you know, we appreciate the consideration, but that we're not going to
just add we do temporary things on the courthouse.
Okay, that's
lawn.
Good.
It is just a temporary thing. You know, United Way, they ask us to
get
put the thermometer. They,
yeah,
you know, they fill out an application and then, you know, for that. But we know it's not a permanent thing. It's going to be taken down within 30, 60 days, whatever
the time courthouse lighting, and we have temporary
permits
for
so
the
it's just courthouse. A, you know, we are
that's
okay with
point,
the
Barb.
Temporary things going up, you know, when they do the Christmas tree and the Christmas decorations and things like that. And you know, they did the I believe it was the KFCs that did the
nativity scene.
The nativity, those are just temporary things, and we are still okay with doing that.
Yes. So in their 100th anniversary, if they wanted to put a little
something
cool up for a month,
correct,
during Rotary Month or something,
we'd yeah, it, we are so still
fill out the application.
They still have to fill out an application.
Yeah. Thanks for bringing that up.
I mean, yeah, we just have to know what's going up and, you know, how long it's going to be there. You know, it's not really. I mean, it's just no, basically asking permission to put something temporarily up, and then it comes down. So I think that I just want to, you know, make that clear that we'll still do that, just not something permanent.
Yep. It's good. That's all I have for old business. And over to you if you want to take it.
Okay.
Right?
Yep.
We're finished old business. We're over to you, new business. You don't have a lot left?
No, I do not.
Okay.
I have one supplemental appropriation. It's for the capital project fund for the Southeast EMS station, which is the 224 station in Bloomville, for $50,000. This is an increase because as we get into this project, this is the first building, we need to make sure that we have phones, security, radios. This is just additional to the contract. So
just have enough money.
Yeah, just so that we have enough money to because we are doing these outside of the actual contract with Klaus Construction.
But just so the public knows, we are on budget. Mm-hmm. We are on time and on budget with that building. Mm-hmm. There's been a couple overs, a couple takeouts. We might be ahead. Big one out, right?
Yeah.
So we're doing great with the budget and the construction of the new building. This is phone security,
All
that kind of stuff, which was not part of the original scope. We were always going to do
that. It was part of it, but I don't know that we ever went in as in-depth as what we figured out we needed to be to pass inspection with the pharmacy board and you know, things like that.
Okay.
So
I think we just had a general scope of it.
It was a general scope, and so this is just the deep dive in, and it might not even cost us $50,000. I just want to make sure that we have enough money in place to cover these costs.
Now we'll know for station and 2, 3, 4.
Yes, so all of this will be wrapped into the remaining stations. So
always, still on, always track, unforeseeable.
Mm-hmm. So end of April, maybe.
Yeah,
kind of thing.
I believe so.
Okay. We have a first
motion to approve the supplemental appropriations as presented.
I'll second that. Any other discussion? Roll call.
Commissioner Franker?
Yes.
Commissioner Schaff?
Yes.
Commissioner Paradiso?
Yes.
And then I only have, the agenda says three resolutions. I had to remove the resolution for the Job and Family Services for pharmacy consulting services and management. They, at their request, the contract was incorrect.
Good catch.
So the first one is a resolution authorizing the Seneca County Board of Commissioners to enter into an agreement contract with Lake Erie Construction. This is for the guardrail installation project for the engineer.
So move.
Second.
Okay, roll call.
Commissioner Franker?
Yes.
Commissioner Schaff?
Yes.
Commissioner Paradiso?
Yes.
The last resolution that I have is designating Tyler Schaff as the DAC chair in place of Anthony Paradiso for the annual Seneca County Health District Advisory Council meeting.
So move.
Second. A little discussion. The president of the Board of Commissioners has that title and that job once a year. I am unable to make that meeting, so Commissioner Schaff would automatically be there as vice president, but they asked that we, health department asked that we formalize this in a resolution. So that's what this is. You'll do a great job, Commissioner.
Thank you.
Thank you. Roll call.
Commissioner Franker?
Yes.
Commissioner Schaff?
Abstain.
Commissioner Paradiso?
Yes.
That's all I got.
Okay. Good job. Thank you. Public comment. Anyone that wants to talk? Mr. Brian Ball's up. Yes, sir.
I've got one comment.
Yes.
I want to go along with you guys. There's only room for one building, one thing on the courthouse lawn, and that is the courthouse.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Thanks. Yep. And I think going forward, that's a good point, public comment. So can we hunt on the county property? And we had all this, so we just said no hunting, and now it's nothing goes on the courthouse. That's our policy. So thank you.
Would you like for me to memorialize that in a resolution?
Yeah, please.
That'd be a good idea.
Yeah. Let's do that, and then that'll take the any politics out of anything. I mean, that's our position, and you know, that's it. So, Adam, welcome back from vacation. Yeah. I haven't seen you for a little bit.
Thank you. Yeah, was on vacation and then was at a BR&E last week for business meetings.
Yeah.
So glad to be back. I do want to quickly let you guys know about just a quick update on the Ralph's parking lot on Washington Street. That was funded with your support and your help through the Seneca County Land Bank, set up a brownfield remediation application for the previous cycle. Thanks to that, we are now able to roll forward funds from that previous round of funding into the remediation of that site through the current consultant. It doesn't have to go back out to bid. So we are now able to get that site officially cleaned up, which, you know, has been well over a decade now of work just to get to this point. So thank you for your support and your help with that. And hope to have that done here sooner rather than later, finally.
So we have the ag, we're in need of a new ag building. I was aware of that. We looked at a new one. We bought the Advertiser Tribune. We're going to go there, right? We have applied for a grant with the government, and we're now pivoting that grant. We're basically rewriting the grant to reflect the new building, the new numbers, plus Congress hasn't approved the budget yet, but we're alive in the, with the process. There's a chance we might get this. So we are going to be asking for, Commissioner Frank will get with you, we're going to be asking for some letters of support that we can attach and send off to Washington, and then other letters we can send off to Senator Reinke in Columbus, right?
Correct.
It's two separate letters because we have two oars in the ground to try to get grant funding for that, our ag building. We have the funds to do it, but we're applying for a grant, and we have plenty of other uses that we could use that money for. But until we get the grant, that money's tied up for the ag building. So we appreciate your help if you get out in rural township, whatever. Okay.
Yeah.
He'll help.
Happy
you.
Happy to help.
Yeah, we just need just a little help on some phone calls, right? And gathering them up, and you know how it works.
Yep.
Thank you. Anybody else want to comment? Going through, we good? Frank, everybody? Brent, welcome. Good to see you.
Good.
Okay, so next meeting will be Thursday.
March 7th.
March 7th. And meeting's adjourned. Thank you.